There's something magical when a film goes through a projector, the beam of light.
That's what Psycho was based on.
This is a shot from Hitchcock.
The camera always sees the truth.
We're going to watch films from throughout your career.
Anyone in the movie world was born to be wild, it was the director of Easy Rider, Dennis Hopper.
Out here in the wilderness fighting Indians and cowboys in every style.
Get your motor running. Head out on the highway.
The film kicked down the doors of Hollywood, was a worldwide success, and Hopper had a cool 7% of the gross.
And then you go for the big money, man, and then you're free. You dig?
His next film bombed, he lost himself in drink and drugs, but still turned in classic performances in films like Apocalypse Now.
This is Chris and Danny, our gang.
With Blue Velvet, he was the comeback kid, and his own comment at the time, "I should be dead or a serial killer," wasn't far off the mark.
There's a crazy guy who lives in there. He's crazy, you know, he's in Blue Velvet, and you don't want to mess with him at all.
When Hollywood wants psychosis in its films, it calls Dennis Hopper.
I've been in a lot of bad movies, but I've always tried to take shit and make gold out of it.
I picked him up at his home, and we drove around Hollywood and talked more at the Chateau Marmont Hotel, the spiritual home of Hollywood rebels, and where he first met James Dean.
Remember this book, Minutes of the Last Meeting?
Oh yeah, very well, yeah.
Which apparently you read as a young man, and it influenced you somewhat. In what way did it influence you?
Well, it showed me that you could be crazier in hell here.
What's it about? What's it about?
It's about insanity and alcoholism.
None of which you touched in your own life, of course. But it seems to argue that in order to be a great artist, you need to be wayward and perhaps a drunk. And that's something that you took to heart.
Oh yeah. Yeah, well, like, you know, I mean, it's not exactly what you should read as advice to your son.
You'll be giving this to your son.
Give him this book and say, you know, this is what Hollywood's all about. I think it might be a mistake. But for a long time, I couldn't imagine acting without drinking. You know, I didn't drink until I got to Hollywood, really. I remember my agent gave me my first martini with an olive in it, you know, and I tasted it. I said, God, this is awful. And he said, it's an acquired taste.
And you thought,
and I acquired that taste really quickly.
So you came to Hollywood and you rehearsed in this hotel, Chateau Marmont.
Right there. Yeah. Yeah, that's where we rehearsed Rebel Without a Cause. In the bungalow. It used to be the most expensive tenement probably in the world. With rats running through the hallways, but
this is us in here.
We cleaned it up a lot. All right.
The director wanted to see James in different costumes, with actors of different height and hair color. It also gave the actors the opportunity to interact with James.
So you met James Dean, and you were cast in a non-speaking role, and you started working with Nicholas Ray. Was he a good director? Will his films be remembered?
Oh yes, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, Rebel Without a Cause certainly will be remembered. I had a very strange relationship with Nick Ray because I was 18 years old. Natalie Wood and I were having an affair, and Nick Ray was also having an affair with Natalie Wood. So Nick and I got in a lot of fights over that, basically. And Jimmy Dean was such a powerful individual. He took over the whole movie, and so he rehearsed everybody. He blocked the scenes primarily. He improvised a lot of the scenes. And Nick allowed him and gave him the space to do that. And that's a good director, but at the time, I didn't know that. So I came out of it thinking that Jimmy Dean directed Rebel Without a Cause. That was my take on it at the time.
I've got here the knife fight scene from Rebel. Do you remember that?
Oh, yeah.
In which you're in the background.
Oh, yeah.
What are you waiting on, Toriador? I thought you wanted a little action.
Now, you crunch chicken,
don't
you...
call me that!
Oh! Hey, Toro!
Hey! Corey Allen, who's the other man here, he catches Jimmy and actually clips him. And Nick sees that he's been hit with the Jimmy's been hit with the knife, and he says, "Cut, cut, cut!" And Jimmy gets furious and grabs Nick and says, "Don't ever, ever say cut. Don't ever, ever say cut to me. I'll say cut if something's wrong. Don't you ever cut the scene." He really cut me, and like, you know, this is part of the scene, and I want that reality. And was furious and walked off the set, and it took a while before we started shooting again.
From that story, you could take the impression that if the actor's more important than the director, maybe that's why you got into trouble with directors.
Well,
if you thought you knew more than they did.
But if a director is saying cut because he thinks something's wrong with the actor, because the actor is having a real response and has been hurt or whatever, that's the actor's call. It shouldn't be the director's call. If something technically wrong with the scene, then the director should say cut.
What did James Dean teach you?
He told me that you must start doing things and not showing them. Watching him act, I've never in my life seen anybody as good an actor as he was. So, you know, it reminds one of, like, I mean, to me, the most important thing that was ever said about creation was Rainer Maria Rilke's Letters to a Young Poet, where he advises this young poet, no matter what kind of poor and indifferent life you have, to find poetry in it. And you must ask yourself, in the stillest moment of your night, if it were denied you to create, would you die? And if your answer is yes, then you have no choice but to be an artist.
I used to fly around quite a bit, you know. I took a lot of unnecessary chances. And I started racing, and now I drive on the highways. I'm extra cautious. Take it easy driving. The life you might save might be mine. You
know? He was going 70 miles an hour on a highway, which is the speed limit, when he died, and a guy came in from the side, Turnip Seed was his name, and he came in at an angle, and there was a stop sign there, and it was dusk, and Jimmy was in a silver Porsche. The guy didn't stop for the stop sign, hit Jimmy right head on, and Jimmy didn't believe in having his seatbelt on, and he was killed in this accident. But it was actually the other guy's fault, because he didn't stop at the stop sign. It wasn't Jimmy's fault at all.
Moving on to the 60s. By this stage, you were married, and your then-wife, Brooke Hayward, later said that in 1966, you took your first LSD or something. She says that was the beginning of the end.
Really?
Oh, really? He says dryly.
I was late taking LSD. I mean, Peter Fonda and all the other people had taken acid in the late 50s and in the early 60s, but I didn't take LSD until I got the part of the pusher in The Trip. And I thought, man, I can't be the connection, giving out acid and not having taken it, you know. So I took a trip, and I had a wonderful trip. It may have freed me up a little more than my ex-wife wanted, but it was a wonderful experience for me.
And Trip was like 67 or something, 68. A whole series of endings happened, you know. Martin Luther King killed, Bobby Kennedy killed, Nixon elected, and then you went on to make this film that
Easy
seemed to be
Rider.
About endings. Easy yeah. Rider. Born to be
wild. Peter made Wild Angels, motorcycle picture, big hit. Then Jack Nicholson made one called Hell's Angels on Wheels, which was another motorcycle picture, and I made one called The Glory Stompers. So we promised each other that we would not do a motorcycle movie because we didn't want to become like singing cowboys or something. I mean, we'd never get out of the genre of motorcycles. So Peter calls me at 3:00 in the morning, wakes me up, and he says, "I had this idea for a film." And I said, "What is it?" He says, "A motorcycle picture." I said, "Well, what is it? What is it?" And he said, "We get these two big gleaming bikes, and we ride across country, and we have a great time at Mardi Gras, and then we go off into Florida, and we're shot by a couple of duck hunters." I said, "I love the idea." I like smoking lightning, heavy metal
thunder, racing with the wind. In the Mardi Gras section of the film, there's a trip sequence. Do you remember that?
Oh, very well. It's primarily based on the Gospel according to Thomas, which is which is something that was found in the Dead Sea Scrolls in 1958. This is Peter talking actually to his mother, because it's information that I had about his mother killing herself. He's saying, "Mother, why did you leave me?" And he started crying because I said, "I want you to talk to your mother, Peter." Okay. So that was that part of it. But in the Gospel according to Thomas, there are things like, "They'll call me the Lord of Peace, but I've come to cast wars and cause divisions, for I only guard the world until the world itself is set afire, for I am the fire, I am the light."
I can feel the outside, but I can't feel the inside. Okay?
So when she's saying, I feel the inside, I feel the outside, these things were lines that I'd given them from the Gospel according to Thomas.
And were you a Christian at this stage, or are you now?
I had been an agnostic, and this was given to me by a prostitute that I knew in New York, and it changed my mind about things, because there were no miracles, there were... it was just a different gospel than I was used to. So anyway, that's basically, and the only moral judgment it really makes is don't lie and don't do what you hate, for all things are manifest before heaven. Well, not lying and not doing what you hate leave you pretty open, you know. You can be destroyed by telling the truth, but you can't really, beyond that, that's about it. You know.
And do you feel you've done that?
Yes, I think I have. Yeah. The best of my ability.
I've got the scene from Easy Rider here where Nicholson and you are talking around a campfire, and it's one of the key dialogue scenes about freedom.
Yeah.
You know, this used to be a hell of a good country. I can't understand what's going on with it. Man, everybody got chicken, that's what happened to me. Hey, we can't even get into, like, a second-rate hotel. I mean, a second-rate motel, you dig? Don't they think we're gonna cut their throat or something, man? Like, they're scared, man. Oh, they're not scared of you. They scared of what you represent to them. Amen. All we represent to them, man, is somebody who needs a haircut. Oh, no. What you represent to them is freedom. What the hell's wrong with freedom, man? That's what it's all about. Oh, yeah, that's right. That's what it's all about, all right. But talking about it and being it, that's two different things. I mean, it's real hard to be free when you are bought and sold in the marketplace.
And who wrote that?
Well, first of all, there's been this incredible, like, you know, thing about Terry Southern having written Easy Rider. Terry Southern didn't write one word of Easy Rider. Not one of his ideas is incorporated in Easy Rider. Terry Southern broke his hip, was unavailable, and the only reason his name is on the screen is because Bert Schneider wanted his name on the screen. The title Easy Rider is Terry Southern's. Beyond that, Peter and I had talked out the whole screenplay, and they were supposed to write it while I was off finding locations. I call and find out they haven't written anything. I get a secretary and I dictate the whole screenplay in 10 days and come out with not a great masterpiece. And then after that, 80% of the film is improvised. This scene was written by me. So that's the story. And then after that, unfortunately, Terry didn't have a percentage of the movie, but when it became famous, then he started calling me and saying, "I want a percentage, I want some money, I'm having problems financially." And then he convinced his son, which is really pathetic to me, his son that he had written it. And then on, and this has become a big, big thing, and it's been things printed in the New Yorker and all over the place, and it really hurts me. It's one of my really, really prized things that I've done. It has nothing to do with Terry Southern, absolutely nothing except the title Easy Rider. It's such a thorn in my side, and I mean...
Did you not try to challenge him legally or something before he died?
No, he died before I could do that.
Famous legacy of this film, it started a new genre, pictures, road movies, etc. And you said this thing, "I'm responsible for cocaine taking in the US."
Well, at the beginning, Peter had it as marijuana, and I said, "Well, we can't we can't carry enough marijuana and dirt bikes to go anywhere, man. It's not going to really work. And then people suggested heroin, and I said, that's not a great idea at all, man. I don't want to promote anything that is heroin. I said, what about cocaine, you know? And I'd read that Freud had used it, and I thought, this must be harmless stuff. So, like, why don't we just, it's a drug of King's, very expensive. We'll do that. And so by introducing cocaine, the year 1969, the movie came out. By 1971, cocaine was everywhere in the street. It was the most prevalent drug in the United States, suddenly.
And so you must regret that.
I can't regret anything that happened. I mean, you know, I can, you know, I mean, I it's not about regretting, really. It's about, it's an unfortunate thing that happened. But I mean, I still like the movie.
Yeah, me too.
Nothing left is all she left.
1971, you made The Last Movie, which is probably your most personal film and nearly ended your career. And it starts off as a standard Western, but then becomes a movie within a movie.
Hey! Hold it! Cut! What the goddamn hell's the matter with you, Tex? Where the hell have you been?
My name's Kins. I'm sorry.
I didn't realize.
I kept jarring the audience out and saying every time there was something that you could start believing was a story.
Come on, Dean, act shut.
I'd stop it and say, no, it's really only a movie, and why are you here? I thought it up when I was doing The Sons of Katie Elder down in Mexico. There was a real Mexican church there, and we built all the buildings and all the things that looked like the facade of a Western. We put right on places, adobes, where people were still living inside. And I thought, wow, you know, what's going to happen to these sets when we leave? Are they going to start acting out the violence?
And in the film you made out of that idea, you show what happens to the locals after the Hollywood crew has left. The Indians copied the filmmaking that they saw being done by Hollywood, and they created the equipment, the cameras and the sound equipment out of what was
bamboo.
Bamboo,
yeah.
And incorporated it into their own rituals.
One of my big fascinations has always been what is real and what's illusion. The real church, the movie set church, the real background, and then suddenly a painting comes into the background. What's a real bullet and what's not? What's a real scar and what isn't a real scar?
Listen, you shouldn't be doing this kind of thing. You're gonna hurt somebody doing that. We don't do that in the movies. We fake everything. It's all phony. Let me show you something. Look. You see where your camera is here?
I've grown up in the movie industry, so it was all about, it was about the movie industry, and it was about those kind of conflicts that I have about the movie industry.
Just like this, just throw it right through there. Okay, go ahead. See what I mean?
But that didn't look right. You gotta try it one more time.
Remember the scene where you walk out of the party and go walk to a wall and cry? Mm-hmm. What were your thoughts about that scene?
That little scene, in my mind, is a sort of homage to James Dean. James Dean came to me on Giant. You know, we were in a restaurant and he called me over to his table and he said, I saw you do a scene today and I thought you were really great in it. So I dropped a little tear out of my eye, you know, and he said, you see that tear? He said, I know what that means. He said, that means you appreciate what I'm telling you. He said, but, you know, when you really have to cry, you have to leave the room. It's not something you share with somebody. And he said, to do that in a movie, to be able to achieve that in a movie, that's really, would be something.
Are you all right?
Oh yeah, sure, I'm fine. I'm just out of getting a glare.
Pauline Kael, that critic, wrote, the only thing that Hopper knows he wants to do is not entertain us.
Yeah, right, yeah. Well, I like the movie. I mean, you know, I won the only prize given in 1971 at the Venice Film Festival. And I got great reviews in Europe, but everyone disliked it, from Stuart Stern, who wrote it with me, to the actors in the film, and people who read the script and so on. All of them think that I made a mistake. I've had a very difficult time fighting an industry that's very powerful. Most of the time fighting them, and sometimes I join them, and then, you know, I'm on the outs again.
Don't shoot!
It's no surprise, is it, that your own favorites of your films are Westerns? Because you came from the heart of the West. Born 36 near Dodge City.
Yeah, in Dodge City.
In Dodge City. And somewhat distant mother and father. Is it true that your father went to war and your mother said he was dead?
Well, he was in the intelligence service in the army. Mm-hmm. And my mother had been informed that my father had been killed. She knew that he hadn't, but that was the word that was put out to everybody else. So that was for the 2 years or 3 years that he was gone, that was what my impression was. And then he came back, and he was a very distant man and constantly working. I said, do what your mother said, and my mother was totally mad, in my opinion. But it was a time of war. Loose lips sink ships, I think, was...
Yeah, and to be born in that place, in Dodge City, where so many of the stories of the West became myths, didn't they? And Wyatt Earp, etc., lived there. And
Doc Holliday.
Doc Holliday, and you were in films like Gunfight at the OK Corral, which in a way was in part at least about your character's loneliness.
I, as a child, was very lonely, and the only way I felt I could stop being unhappy and stop being lonely was to become something like an artist that would be so beautiful that everybody would say, wow. The time when you couldn't identify with your parents and you couldn't identify with anyone, any of your surroundings, so you wanted new surroundings and new dreams and new ideas and new people and new things.
I didn't see a mountain until I was like 13 years old. I didn't see a skyscraper until I was 13, and I had a vivid imagination. So, I mean, I was thinking, my skyscrapers were really big and my mountains were huge. And when I saw the ocean, I was very disappointed because it was the same horizon line that I saw in the wheat field. So I couldn't quite figure that. I don't know what I thought I was going to see when I looked at the ocean.
Easy ride.
After your first stint in Hollywood, you went back to live in the desert, and in 1971, Kit Carson made a documentary about you.
He shot it in 3 days, made it look like it was over a year.
Yeah, including like orgy scenes and everything.
There were some great orgy scenes.
I'm sure you didn't enjoy doing those at all.
No, the two girls in the bathtub, that was really imposed upon me. It was terrible.
I think that we could drop our clothes as little children and trample on them and be a lot closer to the truth of life.
And in it you tell this fascinating story about Charles Manson, where he wanted you to play him in a film, is that right?
Oh, yeah.
By this stage, of course, Manson had been arrested for masterminding the murder of Sharon Tate and her friends in the Hollywood Hills.
I assumed that he'd seen Easy Rider, but he'd actually seen a television show where I played a guy who tried to choke the judge, and they finally tie me up in the courtroom. So he had seen that, and he had done that. And he had been tied up in the courtroom. He wanted me to direct his life.
He said that, like, you know, he was a big star, and like his whole life, that he had been acting out a movie, but there hadn't been any movie cameras yet. Well, he says that he's already dead, so not to worry about him, and that you're dead too, and that we're all dead. He blames it on society. He says, if I'm your garbage, you made me your garbage.
Unfortunately, the people that had been murdered by him were friends of mine. Jay Sebring was a really dear friend of mine. So I had nothing but hateful feelings for Charles Manson.
But why did you even see him then if he had killed your friends? Just out of intrigue?
No, because like Kit Carson kept on me and on me and on. You know, Manson's been asking for you. We want to get this. And I said, oh God, okay. And so I went and saw him.
1973, you made this film Tracks.
No one showed up. No one. Let's just lower it, okay? Let's lower it.
I've taken a coffin all the way across country that I'm burying my friends, supposedly, but inside I brought back all these weapons, which I then go on a rampage and start killing people and so on.
Do you mind if I have a moment alone with my friend? Please, give me an hour. Give me an hour. I have things I have to do.
That's improv again. Mm.
Got a lot of things I have to do and a lot of things I don't.
The loving and hating is, again, out of the Gospel according to Thomas.
I love. I really do love. I love. And I hate. And because I love, because I love, I hate, because I love, I hate, because I love, because I love. You motherfuckers!
the emotion comes out of, emotional memory and sense memory.
Could you describe how sense memory works?
You have to trick your subconscious. I mean, you tell a story, and when you tell a story about, you say, well, my mother died when I was a kid, or my mother slapped me one time, or so on. You don't feel anything. Nothing happens. You have to forget what happened, basically, and you have to relax and wipe yourself clear of, like, you know, of any preconceived ideas of what it's about. And then you have to try to find all the tension areas in your body and so on and so forth, and, like, you know, and just relax. And then you have to go back through, like, things like, what was I wearing that day? And then it's what can you see? Can you see the table? Can you see anything? Can you hear anything? And you go through your senses: seeing, smell, taste, hearing, touch. And then one of these things will bring back the emotion of what happened at that time, you know.
We know this town, don't we? We know where we are. Okay. All right. Let's cool it out here.
You sort of build up a repertory of these various emotions. It's, I think Stanislavski called it your golden box, and you only open it. You have to keep replacing these emotional memories, because every time you use one, you have to keep filling up the box again with new memories, because you can wear them out.
But I heard the director of True Grit said to you when you were working with John Wayne.
Duke doesn't dig that method shit. You know?
And then a very different Vietnam movie, the most famous of them all.
There's mines over there, mines over there too! And watch out, those goddamn monkeys bite you, I'll tell you. I'm an American! Yeah! American civilian. Hi, Yanks. Hi. American. American civilian, it's all right. You got the cigarettes, and that's what I've been dreaming of. Who are you? Mm. Who are you? I'm a photojournalist.
Why did you say that to him in the scene?
Who?
Something clever like that. When he says, who are you?
Why
did you say, who are you?
Because I haven't learned my lines yet.
I know, you've had
them
for 5 days.
The other thing I'd like to say is that...
Those glasses are...
These glasses, I can't see anything through them. But, like, you know... Every crack represents a life I've saved. You know what I mean? You represent a life I've saved.
He wants to thump you, I think.
The director, you know, the director says, you don't know your lines. And then, like,
well,
you know,
if you know your lines, then you can forget them.
Oh,
you know more or less.
I see. But that's what I'm trying to do. Forget those lines.
No, but it's no good to forget them if you never knew them.
The point is this. There was no dialogue. We would sit, Francis and I would sit in the morning, he would write these things, we'd write these things and so on, write them out, and he'd say, now this is a general idea. So, okay, great. Then we'd go and improvise. There was nothing, I mean, he's talking about learning your lines. What lines, Francis? Good God, I've been improvising everything.
You should have just said that to him?
Well, I mean, yeah, but I mean, you know. But I mean, I'd say, oh, well, I mean, about learning my lines, I guess I didn't learn my line. Yeah, well, you should learn your line. There wasn't any lines. There wasn't any end of the movie. There was no character for me to play. And then suddenly they shut down the whole production when Brando arrived, and Brando and Francis go off on a boat for a 2-week ride on a boat because Francis wants to read Marlon, Heart of Darkness, and 900 of us are sitting there, crew and cast are sitting waiting for them to come back. When they come back, he says, Marlon has decided that, like, you know, that he wants to give you this part. And what they give me is, in the book, is the Russian Jew who has all these things like tarot cards. So that's who the photo news journalist became, was Uspensky's tarot card fool,
yeah,
who had all the secret ones of the world, but he couldn't remember how to use them.
And Brando wouldn't do his, because you were supposed to have scenes acting directly with him, and he wouldn't do them with you.
Well, he would work first, and then he wouldn't be on the same set with the same time. So he would do his scenes, and I'd come in the next night and do mine. And so at one point, they come in and they said, "Well, you know, Marlon called you a whimpering dog last night, and like threw bananas at you." So all night I've got this guy Tommy Shaw, who's an ex-baseball pitcher, who's a prop guy, throwing bananas at me. You know? Which is, totally insane.
There's only love and hate. You either love somebody or you hate them.
That's where I go into my thing about dialectic logic and 1 through 9 numbers, and there's no fractions, no maybes or supposes.
1 through 9, no maybes, no supposes, no fractions. You can't travel in space. You can't go out into space, you know, without, like, you know, with fractions. What are you going to land on? 1/4, 3/8? What are you going to do when you go from here to Venus or something?
All that's improvised. None
of that. Did Francis have a clue what you were talking about?
No, that's when he would come out and say, "What? Do the line. What lines, Francis?"
In the mid-80s, when you went through that rehab and everything, were you worried that sober you would be a straighter but less creative person?
Yeah, I thought so. I mean, you know, you start using these drugs as crutches to get yourself through performances and through things. So when I stopped, I really wondered if I could, you know, really do it. So I had to go back and really go back to my Strasbourg training. And my first year I was sober, I did 3 films, which were probably the best performances I've given ever. One was Blue Velvet. Mm-hmm. Then I went right from Blue Velvet to Indianapolis, Indiana to do Hoosiers.
Oh, yes.
And then from Hoosiers I went back to Los Angeles and immediately started River's Edge. And these 3 films were my sober experiences. It was scary in the beginning, but it was so much easier, actually, because drugs induce such paranoia and schizophrenia in some of us that the anguish of having, it's not helping you really, it's you're having to work through these things.
And talking in Blue Velvet, famously you phoned David Lynch and said, "I am Frank Booth." Now, what elements of his identity was it? Was it the aggressive, psychotic feelings for women? Like, had you been aggressive to women in your life?
Well, I think it was more about, I had been aggressive to women, but not quite the way Frank Booth had. I think it was more the criminal element of Frank Booth that I understood, because of coming out of a drug culture, one was exposed to a lot of criminals and a lot of, like, dealers and a lot of, like, you know, borderline psychotic people. The only problem I had was when he gave me the helium, because it was written as helium in the mask to use. And the first day of shooting, we do the scene where I come in and ask for my bourbon and, like, you know, and rape her and cut her velvet thing and do this whole number on Isabella Rossellini. And it's a big scene, and I tried to do "Baby Wants to Fuck," with this helium, and helium doesn't do anything to you, it doesn't disorient you or anything. And when I read this, I really thought of an amyl nitrate or nitric oxide or something that gets you high for a few minutes. And he said, "Well, I don't know what those things are." And I said, "Well, let me show you what it would look like if one was using them." So I did the thing, and you know, I acted with it. He said, "Oh, I love that, I love that."
"Mommy. Mommy.
Mommy loves you.
Baby wants to fuck. Get ready to fuck! You fuckers, fucker! You fucker! Don't you fucking look at me!"
And for years I thought that was an incredible contribution that I gave. And then about a year and a half ago I was sitting and I was thinking about David. And I was thinking about the part. And I thought, you know how strange it would have been if I had played it with just the voice changing and no emotional, no emotional thing. How different and
so
how strange and how really sinister that would have been, you know. But again, that would have been somebody else, you know. But I was just thinking how great David Lynch is and how bizarre that was and how bizarre his mind is, that it didn't disorient your mind, it just made your voice change. And this guy wore this just to change his voice and, like, sound like Daffy Duck or whatever.
And what did you think of the feminist reaction to Blue Velvet? And that scene you're talking about, the rape scene, she very gently says yes after you've hit her. Now, surely you understood people's problems with something like that?
I understood that, like, a lot of women were, like, terrified at the movie. I mean, I remember, like, having dinner with Bert Schneider and this young girl coming, trembling. Her boyfriend brought her up and said, she doesn't want to meet you, but I want her to meet you, show you just a regular guy. And she was standing there trembling. She couldn't look at me. And Bert said, "I haven't seen this movie," because Blue Velvet had just, he said, "I haven't seen this movie, but you must be doing some terrible things in that movie." If somebody said, "I've never seen this in my life," somebody trembling like that. But no, I didn't think of the consequences of what what it would do to anybody to watch that movie. I hadn't worked in so long, man, and I'd been incarcerated and locked up, and I was ready to work, and I thought it was a wonderful role.
In 1988, you said in several interviews that you supported George Bush. That's a surprise.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I did.
Why did you do that?
Well, first of all, I never really cared for Ronald Reagan, but I did vote for Reagan because I wanted to, and at that point, I was the first in my family to ever change from being a Democrat to Republican because I was tired of what I considered the welfare state. And then when it came to Bush, I thought it was really an incredible thing to have an ex-head of the CIA become president, because that for once in our lives, the president wouldn't be paranoid about the CIA because they'd have full knowledge of it and not be paranoid about it.
Is that a serious answer, or are you being sarcastic?
No, I'm being serious.
But
I'm being very serious.
I think people will be surprised that, you know, you're seen as a really anti-authoritarian, counterculture figure, and that here you were shoring up.
You don't think the CIA is?
CIA, well, in the wrong way it is, of course.
I suppose counterculture kind of.
It is, of course.
But I mean, I really felt that it would be refreshing to have somebody that came from that position in that position and have no paranoia and no, thing about it. I mean, I really did.
Why did you do the Ford Cougar advert in the UK?
Oh, I thought it was terrific. I loved that.
But can you understand that some people thought, what a sellout, you know, we believed in that character in Easy Rider and he's stamping on it?
Yeah, but, you know, I mean, I find people really short-sighted, don't they? I mean, like, what do actors know about politics? I mean, they're just another citizen, you know what I mean? So, like, why should they be held up as something they know about politics? The other thing, what I wanted to tell an Easy Rider, I told. But I'm not an Easy Rider anymore, and I don't dress like that, and I don't have long hair anymore, and I'm not that guy anymore.
Sure.
So, like, you know, I'm another person, and I still have very strong human beliefs and moral beliefs about the homeless, the poor, the disenfranchised. But I'm not any longer thinking that communism or socialism is going to cure the world. I think that less government and more responsible people are what really is needed. I don't think more government is better for anybody.
But couldn't you say that people will think that's because he doesn't want to pay as much tax because he's richer now, he's earning more money?
I paid 50%. How much more can I pay? I guess you pay a little more in England.
Yes, and try Sweden. How often are you absolutely blissfully happy?
How often?
Yeah.
Well, hopefully every day. You know, I should be. I've lived a very privileged life. I've had a lot of problems creatively in my life, but there's nothing that, like, you know, that I mope about or cry about or bitch about. You know, I've lived a very privileged life, and I wish my career would have gone a lot different ways a lot of times, but it's not anything I can really complain about. Let the historians complain about it.
Then I fall asleep to dream my dreams of you. In dreams I walk with you.
Great, man. Thank you.
See ya.
Have a good trip back.
Thank you.
Okay, see you guys.
Yeah.